Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Hallelujah. And we appreciate Jesus in the house. Come on, put your hands together. Are you happy? Are you happy? Some of us are not happy. We're looking sad. Put your hands together. Let the devil be ashamed of himself. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. The hour has come for God to send forth his word through his servant. With joy in my heart, I welcome once again Pastor Maria. Let's appreciate Jesus in the house. Come on, put your hands together. Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! God is good.
All the time.
That's right, all the time. Even when we feel it and even when we don't, God is good. Well, I just want to say thank you for the invitation to come to speak to you again today. Yesterday was an amazing day. I believe that God touched people's lives and spoke to them through not just the word, but through the prayers too. You know, God has many ways of reaching us, and he'll reach us whichever way we'll allow him to connect with us. But we're going to come around the word now, the Holy Bible, the written word of God. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for this word this morning. We thank you, God, and it is the bread of life. It is life-giving and life-changing. And I thank you, God, that Jesus came. The word became flesh and he dwelt amongst us. And God, you have set it in our hearts, not just on stone, not just on tablets, but in our hearts this morning, God, that your word is the way, that your word is the truth. And by your word, Lord, we are changed from glory to glory and transformed in Jesus' name. And we all said?
Amen.
Amen, amen. Okay, right, well, we're going to get into the word. There are 4 points, if you're taking notes this morning, that I'm going to look at. We've been doing a theme, Who Am I? Point one, you can't enter the promised land with the wrong identity. We're going to look at that this morning. Point two, how do you see yourself? We touched on it yesterday, but I just want to come back to that today. It's very important how you see yourself. Point three, know who you are in Christ. You are in the world, but you are not of the world. You have a new identity. You were born again. You've been transformed from one kingdom to another. We have to know who we are in Christ. Out of that is how we will live. And that will determine whether we live victoriously or whether we live in defeat. We've got to know who we are in Christ. And point four, God has already prepared a way. Did you get that? God has already prepared the way, church. He's already prepared it. We are not struggling to fight through to make a way. He said, I've already prepared the way. Now go in and possess your land. Our first portion of scripture this morning will be taken from Numbers 13:27. So if you'd like to just open your Bible there. Numbers 13. And I'm going to read from verse 26. Okay. The men went back to Moses and Aaron, the entire Israelite community in the wilderness of Paran of Kadesh. They brought back a report from them and the whole community, and they showed them the fruit of the land. They reported to Moses, we went into the land where you sent us. Indeed, it is flowing with milk and honey, and here is some of its fruit. However, say however.
However.
However, the people living in the land are strong, and the cities are large and fortified. We also saw the descendants of Anak there, the Amalekites, the living in the land of the Negev, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites living in the hill country, and the Canaanites live by the sea along the Jordan. But verse 30 came, praise God. Then Caleb quieted the people in the presence of Moses, and he said, we must go up and take possession of the land, because we can certainly conquer it. But the men who had gone up with him responded, we can't go up against the people because they are stronger than we are. So they gave a negative report to the Israelites about the land they had scouted. The land passed through to explorers, one that devours its inhabitants, and all the people we saw in it are men of great size. We even saw the Nephilim there, the offspring of Anak, where the descendants from the Nephilim. To ourselves, we seem like grasshoppers, and we must have seemed the same in their sight. You see, church, how you see yourself is really important. Here we've seen that they have said, how we see ourselves must be how they see us. Did you get that? How you see in yourself, you can get this thinking and this mentality that it must be how other people see us. If that is the case, if there be any truth in that, then it is really important how we see ourselves. We need to see ourselves like God sees us. We need to see ourselves through the finished work of the cross. We need to see ourselves in the light of the written word of God. We need to see ourselves called out and appointed and anointed of Him. How we see ourselves matters. Moses sent these spies out in to the land of Canaan to spy out the land. Not many of them came back with a good report. And sometimes we're a little bit like that with God. He tells us in our life, now I want you to go in and I want you to possess that job. I want you to go in and I want you to possess that area in your life that you've been fighting with. But sometimes we come back to God with a bad report. We tell God, how can we do that? Who am I to be able to say that? Who am I to be able to go there? That's what some of these men came back saying. Some of these men saw themselves as grasshoppers, and so did the others. But Caleb, I believe, was of a different spirit. Caleb was of a spirit that believed that God was God. Caleb was a man after God's heart, and he believed that what God said, God would do. Praise God for people that are sitting in the body of Christ, that are in the house of God with a different spirit. With a spirit that says, no matter what we see, we will go in and possess the land because God has said we can take it. We have to have a different spirit. We have to have a Caleb spirit. Caleb saw that the land was promised and that God, who had promised it, would keep him. And we have got to see that the land that God has promised us in our lives, whatever that might be, whatever God needs you to possess, you need to be as Caleb was. You need to understand that what God has promised, God is well able to equip you to possess it. Stop looking at what might seem to be giants. Sometimes some people are dealing with the giant of insecurity. For some of us, we're dealing with the giant of lack of finance. For some of us, we might be dealing with the giant of fear. For some of us, we might be dealing with the giant of sickness. Whatever your giant is today, understand that before God sent these men into this land and the man of God gave them the commission, God knew what was in the land of Canaan. It did not faze God that all these tribes were there, the Hittites, the Amorites. It didn't faze God. And sometimes we get a little bit shocked at what God asks us to do. But I want to encourage you, church. God knows exactly what is in that land that He's sending you to. And He's not scared of it, and He's not intimidated by it, and neither should you be. Because if God be for us, who can be against us? I think it's really interesting that when these spies came back to the man of God, Moses, they never once mentioned the God that had delivered them out of Egypt. They never once thought about or gave mention to the God that delivered us from the hand of the Egyptians, from the armies and from the slavery that He brought us out of. They never once took thought to mention they are still serving the same God. It's important for us to sometimes remember what God has done so that it will give us courage to have that strength for what God will do. Stir up the gift that is within you. Put yourself in way of remembrance of the goodness of God. It's not God that needs reminding, it's us. We are too quick to forget the blessing of God that we've had. And we're too quick to run to God and tell Him what we can't do. But here we see that these spies, they forgot about that God that had led them out, that had parted the Red Sea, and they had walked through on dry land. Can you imagine that? What would be more difficult? To walk through the Red Sea on dry land or to face giants? If God can part the Red Sea in your life, sister, brother, He can deal with the giants. He can deal with the giants. And he can deal with the enemy like he did as they walked through the Red Sea. The enemies could not gain ground on them, and God destroyed them. And God will destroy our enemies if we do what he tells us to do. You see, church, it didn't matter to most of these men, to most of these spies, how big God was. What mattered to them was how small they were. And that's where we miss it. We have got to understand that in Christ we can do all things because he is with us and he called us and ordained us. So church, it doesn't matter how small you are. You've got to start thinking about how big God is. The creator of the universe. The one that threw the stars into the sky and laid the oceans out across the dry land. If you believe you are insignificant today, if you believe that you are unimportant today, no matter how big your God is, you will pull back. You will step out of the race and you'll let life pass you by and you'll never really step into the fullness of what God has already prepared for you. You won't possess your promised land. We have got to understand that God is bigger than anything or anyone he calls us to be or any place he calls us to go. You can sing the songs. You can pray the prayers. You can speak of his power. But if you see yourself weak, and if you see yourself small, and if you see yourself at the wrong age, or you came from the wrong family, or you had the wrong start, or something happened to you in the past, whatever you think about you will stop God from doing his will in your life. You've got to see yourself in Christ. How do we see ourselves? You cannot possess your promised land with the wrong identity. And most of these spies had the wrong identity. Yesterday, Pastor Tom talked to us about purpose. And you'll understand what it means to have your purpose. Well, let me tell you, having those papers permits you to do certain things, to go certain places, and to be in a certain situation. It's the same in God. You have to have God's papers above any paper above your life. Your identity needs to be in this paper above everything. This paper just doesn't open the doors of this life, but this paper will open the doors of the next life. It's important where we take our identity from. Our identity as Christians does not come from our culture. It does not come from our background. It doesn't even come from our church. It comes from our Saviour, and his name is Jesus Christ. So we have got to get our identity from the right place. You see, Jesus is not threatened, and he's certainly not weak. And when we put our identity in him, and we take our identity from him, we won't be intimidated, and we won't be weak either. God says, that's your land, church. Now go and get it. I wonder what land God is saying to you today. That's yours. Go and get it. He didn't tell them how. He didn't tell them what they would need to take. He just said, go and take it. I've prepared it. And you know, church, it takes us a level of trust. We've got to start leaning into what God says God will do. In spite of how we feel, in spite of what we think, we've got to learn to trust that the word of God is ultimate. It's total. And it is the truth. There are many people that will tell you many things that might be true. And they are a truth. But the word of God is the truth. It is the truth. So we have to get our identity from the right place. If we have the wrong identity, we will not possess our promised land. We will think of all the reasons why we cannot. And we will not think of the reasons why we can. We are in him. We belong to Christ. These men didn't make it. The men that came back with a negative report. A negative report sounds like this, I can't. A negative report sounds like this, I won't. A negative report sounds like this, I'm not strong enough. A negative report sounds like this. I've got other things to do that are more important to what God told me to do. A negative report sounds like this. Well, my friends come first. negative report. We have got to have a good report. You know, these men that came with a negative report, you know where they ended up? Stuck in the wilderness. Living in tents. Never possessing their promised land. Living in tents in the wilderness for 40 years. And you know, fortunately for some of us, we wonder why we're living in a tent. I just want to wake you up this morning. I just want to challenge your mind. I just want to challenge your thinking of, oh my goodness, do I need to change the way I think? Do I need to change what I am identifying myself with? Do I need to even change my company? Because the people that I'm keeping are saying everything we can't do. And what I really need is to be with people that tell me I can do. Hallelujah. God has got a promised land for you. And he says, now go in and get it. I love it. Then Caleb. You see, in order for Caleb to be heard, in verse 30, it says he first had to quieten the people. And in order for you to be heard, and in order for God to be heard in your life, there are certain things that you might need to quieten. You might need to quieten yourself. You might need to be still and know that he is God. And he has got it all at hand. You might need to know that God has seen the giants that you're facing. And you need to wait on him to find out, how do I deal with that God? The men didn't make it. They spent their lives in tents, stuck in the wilderness, surviving. Church, God does not want you to survive. God does not want you to have an attitude, I'm surviving this life. I'm surviving this week. I'm surviving this job. I'm surviving this marriage. I'm surviving this relationship. God wants you to have the attitude that I am a victorious believer. I am living a life. I'm not surviving it. I'm on point, I'm on time, and I'm on course. We are not called to survive. We were born again to live and to live in victory. That's what God wants for you. Number two, how do you see yourself? How do you see yourself? Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 says this. Then God himself, then God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. I want you to get that. According to our likeness. They will rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the animals in all the earth, and the creatures that crawl on the earth. Verse 27. So God created man and woman in his own image. He created him in the image of God. He created them, male and female. God created man and woman in his image. Somebody said it earlier on this morning. I like to just mention it again. We are first a spirit. And we are sent here to master this human life. We are not a human sent here to master the spirit life, church. We are first a spirit because God said, you created in my image and he is the spirit. And them that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. We are created in the image of God. Let us make them in our image. We are first a spirit being. Seek first the kingdom of God. Seek first that which is spiritual if you want your life to be blessed. And the Holy Spirit will lead you and teach you how to do this human life on earth well. He will show you things to come. He will speak to you and tell you what God wants. Well, you have to understand you are first a spirit being. God does not want to connect with your flesh. He wants to connect with your heart. The heart of man is the spirit of man. And it doesn't mean this physical heart, this heart that pumps blood around the body. It means the core of a man is the spirit of a man. And that is what God wants to be changed in our lives. You see, when you understand that you are first a spirit, one of the first things that will happen is your priorities will change. I'll guarantee you. When you're obedient to that and you understand you are first a spirit, your priorities will change. Because what pertains to life life into godliness would be the first thing on your list. And it makes for a great happy life. It makes for joy. This joy unspeakable and full of glory. Who wants it? I do. I'm not enduring this life on earth till I get to heaven. I'm living it. I'm owning it. I'm possessing it. And I'm enjoying it. And that is what God wants for all of us. He wants us to enjoy life. So how you see yourself is very important. You've got to see yourself that you were created in His image. We have to identify ourselves with the image of God. When you identify yourself with the image of something, you sound like it, you look like it, and you act like it. If I wanted to recreate myself to be like Cardi, who's with me today, how I would do that? I would try to speak like Cardi. I would try to dress like Cardi. I would try to live like Cardi. I would try to work like Cardi does, because I'm trying to reproduce her in me. Likewise it is with God. We are created in His image, and we are supposed to be ambassadors of Christ. To see God is to see Jesus, and to see Jesus is to see God. They're three in one: Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We have to identify ourselves with the image of God, our Creator, who we were created to be like. You see, we need to tell ourselves, right? We need to tell ourselves when it's hard, I can do all things. Why? Because I'm strong, because I'm clever, because I'm educated, because I have a degree or a PhD. No, I can do all things through Christ, because He is the one who will strengthen me. And let me tell you, you can do far more with the strength of God in one day than you will ever do with your own strength in a lifetime. We need the strength of God. We need the strength of God. What God says about you, church, is truer than what anyone else will ever say about you. That has to be the first most thing in your mind, what God says about you. What God says about you is truer than what anybody else would say. We can sing the songs and we can pray the prayers and we can speak of His power, but if you see yourself weak, you won't make it. Whatever you think about yourself is important. God wants you to see that you are created in His image. You have to know who you are in Christ. Because when you're born again, you are not your own, but you've been bought with a price. And let me tell you, the price was very high. It was very high. But the amazing thing about that price is it paid for everything. What a life. What a life. You know, the price of the cross paid for what the richest man on the planet of the earth couldn't buy you. Your salvation.
Hallelujah.
Your eternal life. Even the richest man, Warren Buffett, could not buy that.
Yes,
that man called Jesus paid the wonderful price of healing. Not any penny, pound, dollar, or any other form of finance on this planet could buy you that. But the blood of Jesus did. We've got to understand that we have been bought with a price, and it's been paid in full. Complete. We have to know who we are in Christ. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 1 and let's see what Paul says to us about this. Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to read from verse 15. This is why, since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I never stop giving thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, would give you a spirit of wisdom and a revelation in the knowledge of Him. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you might know what the hope of His calling is, what are the glorious riches of His inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of His power to us who believe, according to the working of His vast strength. I pray above all that you understand, and that the eyes of your heart be enlightened. It's showing us here, the church, your physical body has eyes, but so does your heart. That the eyes of your heart, you see the spirit man, the heart of a man, he has eyes. And when the world, when you look out at the world and you think that's impossible, there's a giant, the spirit man inside of you is screaming out to you, with God all things are possible, we're going to go in and we're going to possess the land. That the eyes of your heart might be enlightened. You see, there are three things that we need to know. First of all, this scripture tells us that we need to know that we have a life that we have been called to live. We are called by Him. We need to know that we are called. We are chosen. He could have chosen your neighbor, but He didn't. He chose you. He could have chose your friend, but He didn't. He chose you. He said, you in John, you did not choose me, but I chose you. What an incredible thought. What an incredible thought. He has a plan. That you would know the life that you are called to live. Number two in this scripture, it shows us. So that we would know all that we have inherited from the Lord. This is what Paul is praying for the church. And number three, that we would know the great power that we have through Christ Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. For the day that the church has a revelation of the great power that works through Christ Jesus in His body. He is the head. We are the body. And you do not detach the head from the body. So what is on the head is flowing down the body. And the completeness in the head, and the vision in the head, and the sight in the head, and the thinking and the wisdom in the head flows down to the body. Because the head is attached to the body. I mean, when you all left home this morning, you made sure that you had your head on your shoulders. You did not bring your body to church and leave your head at home. Likewise in the body of Christ. He is the head. And what's on Him is flowing down on us. But we've got to want it, church. We've got to identify with who He is. And therefore we will connect with who we are. His glorious body, His beautiful bride. Notice the first thing that Paul prayed is that we would know who we are. That is so key for your life. That you know who you are. That you're not guessing. That you're not hoping. That you're not wishing, but you know who you are. We are called to be a Christian. We are called to be ambassadors of Christ. We are set apart for Him. You need to know what the hope of your calling is. You need to know what it is to be called a Christian. You need to understand and know what it is to be part of His family. In the spirit of unity, through the bonds of love. All be that the church has the spirit of unity in the bonds of love. I believe that there will be a mighty revival in the land if the church would just get into the spirit of unity in the bonds of love. We are different. You know why? We were meant to be. Because where I'm weak, you're strong. And where you're strong, I'll be weak. In any family that you've got, I've got two children, two sons, 23 and 18. They're very different. Two sons, same mum and dad, same house, same principle, completely two different characters. Is one wrong and one right? No. They're both right. They're just different. And we have got to understand and come to a place where we agree with one another around the Word of God. There might be different things that we do. We might dress differently. We might look differently. We might sing differently. But there is one Father, one Jesus, and one Holy Spirit. And it is that we come together on.
Yeah.
We are the body of Christ, not a body. And we have got to cross these barriers that society is trying to put up and bring into the church, that you're a body, not with the body. We're all part of each other. There's only one shepherd. His name is Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And we're all serving Him.
Yeah.
So we are part of the body of Christ. And I just love how diverse it is. I just think, wow, what heaven is going to look like is just going to be incredible. Just going to be incredible. Hallelujah. So through prayer, Paul isn't asking for more power. And I want you to get this, church, from this portion of scripture here. He didn't say, I'm praying for you, church, that you have more anointing, that you have more Holy Spirit, that you have more word, that you have more prayers. He said, no, church. He says, I'm praying for you that you know what you have. It's time for the church to have its eyes open, the body of Christ to have its eyes open to know what you have. We're walking in darkness, and it's not because we haven't been given the light. It's because we're just not opening our eyes to see. You know when you walk into the room and you're trying to find something in your house and it's dark, it's in the evening time, what's the first thing you do? Put on the light. Why do you put on the light? So you won't stumble, so you won't fall, and so you'll find the very thing you're looking for. Well, this word of God is our light. And when we're in a dark place, we need to switch on the light so that we won't stumble and we won't fall and we will find what God has set for us. So we have to know who we are. We have to know what we've inherited. We have to know that we are called. You see, when somebody tells you you're called, you think, all right, yes, sister, that's wonderful. Praise God. I like the idea of that. That sounds amazing. But inside, behind all of that, you're thinking, but I could never do that. Well, that's not going to get us anywhere. You've got to know that you are called. Because when you know that you are called, you'll act like you are called. You'll start seeking the word. You'll start praying. You'll start praising. You'll start being planted. You'll start evangelizing. You'll start making room in your car to bring your neighbours to church on a Sunday morning. You'll start giving out leaflets so you can connect with the person. And you can invite them, listen, this is a church I go to on Sunday. You need to come. They're amazing, the family I'm part of. Church is incredible. You really need to be there. Because you've got no idea what you're missing when you're not. He saved us to go. And it's really interesting here. He just did lead these men out of the wilderness, out of Egypt, out of captivity. And then when they got out of captivity, the next thing God told them was go. Let me tell you why God brought you out of the world. To go. To go into the land and to possess it. And to take everybody with you. I tell people in my life, my attitude is this. I'm going to heaven and I'm taking everybody with me. I'm not leaving anybody. And I couldn't care less if I look crazy doing it. I believe heaven's real. I believe that God says, and if you know me, I'm going to take you with me. Because that's where I'm going. We've got to be passionate about what God has called us to be and how God has called us to live. We have to know that we have, Paul said, notice that, you have an inheritance. The inheritance that you have is not based on what you can do or what I can do. Thank God for that. That takes the pressure off a little bit. The inheritance that we have is because of what Jesus has already done. It's because of what he already made available. We have an inheritance. And it's a good inheritance. And it's a blessed inheritance. And it's a rich inheritance. And it will cause us to increase and not decrease. The inheritance that God has given us will cause us to be the head and not the tail. It will cause us to be above and never beneath. We have an inheritance. We have to believe that we have already been given these things and we have to possess them. We have to know that we have great power. Incredible. We have great power. Not we're going to get great power. Not if we pray enough we'll get great power. Not if we read our Bible enough we'll get. We do those things because we believe. That's why we do that. Because we're believers. We're not trying to get anything more. We're just trying to understand what we already have. And if we would just open our minds and open our hearts to know that we have great power, I wonder how much more we would change in our lives. I wonder how much more we would evangelize and understand that we have great power and Satan has no rule over us. No devil in hell, no demon on earth can stop the power of Christ. Because at his name, every knee must bow. Hallelujah. Paul is showing us it's not about having more church. Some of you might have come to church this morning and been thinking and feeling, Lord, I need more. What God has sent me to tell you is, you don't need any more. You just need to receive what I've already given you. You need to walk in the revelation of what you already have. It will be like me bringing a shopping bag full of goods, full of something, and I give it to Cardi. But if she never opens up that bag, she will never know what's inside of it. And the word of God is the same. We have been given the word of eternal life. We have been given the word of victory. This is the wisdom of God. This is the will of God. People say to me, well, Maria, I've been a Christian a long time now, and I don't know what the will of God is for my life. I say, read this. This is the will. He's not going to tell you anything else bar this. This is the will of God. We have to be faithful with what he's already given us, because then we're good stewards. So we have to understand that we have been given great power. We have to know it. I wonder how different we would pray if we really knew that. I wonder how less we would struggle with the challenges we face if we really knew that. If we really believed that when we spoke to the mountain and we doubted not in our heart and we told it to be cast into the sea and it would be, I wonder how different we would be. Church, we have it. We have the faith of God. We have the Spirit of God and we have the Word of God. We have everything that we will ever need to live an amazing, victorious life. You will only get it when you know it. If anybody dies in your family and they leave an inheritance, you have to go and you have to find out what it is and then you have to receive it. And you know, a lot of times we're really great at asking, but we're not really good at receiving. Because we've got this work mentality, right? That unless I've worked for it, unless the sweat has come off my brow, unless the skin has come off my hands, I shouldn't really have it. That's not the way God sees it. God says, I've sent Christ and he paid that price. He took that sweat away. He took that skin from your hands away. And he said, now enter into my rest. You see, church, for the body of Christ, your labor is to enter into rest, not enter into work. Now, yeah, we all have jobs. That's responsibility. But I'm not talking about things of this natural world. I'm talking about things of the Spirit, things of God's world. We have to labour to enter into his rest. And you know what? When you know who you are, when you know you have an inheritance, when you know that he has called you, when you know your identity is in him, it's a lot easier to rest in that, even in the battle. There are some of you here this morning, and you've been in a fire in your life. You've been in a fiery trial. And you've been saying to God, get me out, Lord. Get me out, Lord. You need to get me out, Lord. I need rescue and you've got to come now. I can't cope. I can't do this anymore. I can't keep going there. I can't keep being me in this. I need to get out. I've come to tell you today that God says he's not taking you out. Now, I know it's not what you want to hear, but Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego were thrown in the fire and God didn't take them out. No, instead, he came where they were. He came where they were. And you've got to understand, even if you're in the fire, God is well able to come in and set you free. It says he bound, they were walking around in the fire, Shadrach and Meshach. They were bound before they were thrown in, but they were walking around praising God. I want to tell you, if you're facing a fire, stop walking around, stop praising God. Stop calling those walls to come down. You've got to know what you have. Because when you do, you will walk in the fullness of it. We've got to understand that God is not interested. He's not interested in, Lord, we'll do this, you do that. No, God says, I'll do this, Maria, then you do that. We are called to follow him. He was never called to follow us. And we've got to stop trying to get God to follow us in our unbelief and our doubt and our wavering. He's not going to do it, church. But he is going to come in the fire and he's going to show you how to praise your way out of it. It said, then lads praised their way out of it and then King Nebuchadnezzar believed. Yeah. You see, what you believe, what you really have, when you really know that you have it, you will influence people in high places, even kings. You will be the influence over them. They won't be the influence over you. Don't try to get God to move where you are. No, instead, move to where He is. Move to where He is. You follow Him. You follow Him. It's not Him following you. You walk with God. You be renewed. You be transformed. You step up in faith. You begin to see you are in Christ. You start knowing the hope of your calling. You follow and obey God. Then all the promises and all the blessings will begin to flow in your life. We have a part to play. It's not all God and it's not all us. It's us with God. It's us with God. It's us with God. Then all the promises are coming on our life. God already dealt with Satan at the cross. Why are you scared of him? Why do you allow him to intimidate you? Why do you allow him to tell you lies and you start believing him and you listen to him? Why bother? He's a liar. There is no truth in him. And he's been defeated. He has no authority. Best thing to do with him? Just ignore him. Pay no attention. Listen to what God says instead. God's already dealt with him. Now we have to walk in victory of that defeat. We have to walk in it because we have to know it. We have to know it's mine. Number four. In closing, number four. God has already prepared a way for you. Ephesians 2:10, page over. It tells us this in Ephesians 2:10. Who am I? Who am I? I'm a new creation. I'm a called one. I have an inheritance in Christ. I'm a follower of God. Who am I? In Ephesians 2:10 it tells us this. For we are His creation, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time so that we should walk in them. We are His workmanship. God prepared a path for you before you ever got here. Before you ever existed. You were in the mind of Christ before you were ever in your mother's womb. He said, Jeremiah, before you were formed, I knew you. I knew you. There's something about knowing that is powerful. He said, I knew you and I called you. And we have got to know that He is God. We're His workmanship. God already made a way for you. You are His handiwork. You're not weak. You're not stupid. You're not poor. You're not below it. You're not lacking. You are His workmanship. To say you're anything else is to say that God didn't do a good enough job for you. Do we get that? I mean, we all do it. And I'm like, Lord Jesus, deliver me from me. I am my biggest challenge. The devil isn't. I am. This flesh. This flesh of mine just wars with this spirit of mine and tries to tell it what it should be. But I have learned that greater is He that's in me, so I'm going to listen to what He says and lean into that than anything my flesh says to me. We are what He says we are. We can do what He says we can do. But we have to know what that is, that we can walk in it. When we say things about God that's different to Scripture, when we say things about us, ourselves, our lives, what we're doing, what we're involved with, when we say things about us that are different to Scripture, we have a completely different vision of us than what God does. What an incredible thought. His vision for you is incredible today. Incredible. So we have to change. We have to think like He thinks. We have to see things like He sees it. And we have to see ourselves above everything like He sees us. Because this life, it's not about me. This life is about the many. Yeah. It's about everybody else that I'm supposed to be with. It's about everybody else I come into connection with. This life God has given me was not for me. It was to give away. He says, I've called you in, now I'm sending you out. We have to understand that we have to get the same vision about ourselves as God has for you, sister and brother. Do you see yourself victorious this morning? Do you see yourself above? Do you see yourself prosperous? Do you see yourself healed? If you see it, you can have it. We didn't regard ourselves after the flesh anymore, Paul said, but we see ourselves as new creations. Stop regarding yourself after the flesh. Stop regarding your church family after the flesh and start seeing them as the new creation that God called them to be. I said yesterday, God did not mend you. He made you new. He did not mend you. He did not do what the hospitals would do to you. He made you new. He did not mend that broken heart. He gave you a new heart. He did not mend that mind that is full of anxiety and depression. He gave you the mind of Christ. He did not mend that blindness. He gave you eyes that you could see because of the Spirit of Christ. He did not mend you. He made you new. Behold, all things have become new. Do we know it? Do we know it? You've got to ask God today, God, help me know it. Help me know it. Help me walk in what you've already given me. Help me understand the things that's in my inheritance that already belong to me. You wrote a will and you left it, Lord, and you put it in writing. And Lord, help me understand this will. This is the will of the Father. You know, it's an incredible thing. Jesus was our example. And it says in Scripture that Jesus said one day, I only do that which I hear the Father speak. Wow. That's my goal in life. That's what I'm after. I'm only going to do what I hear the Father speak. If he doesn't say do it, I'm leaving it alone. I just want to do what he tells me to do. And you know, sometimes the challenge with that is, what God tells you to do might not look significant. It might look very insignificant. But you know, when Jesus turned up and he went to Samaria, I love it, he says to his disciples, I must need go to Samaria. They were terrified. Like, go to Samaria, you're a Jew. They'll kill you, they'll kill us. Let's not go that way, Jesus. Let's just do the long route. But Jesus said, I but must need go to Samaria. Do you know why? For one woman. For one woman that day. She was coming to the well and he wanted to be there for her. Hallelujah. See, Jesus knows where you are. When you're afar off. And he said, but I must need go to their house. I must need go to their church. I must need go to their family. Because I've got something I need to give them. You've got to understand that God wants us to know what we have. He wants us to know the Saviour. Jesus believes in you entirely. Yeah. Not conditionally. We do that to each other.
Yeah.
But Jesus doesn't do that. He believes in you entirely. That's why he saved you and he called you. We don't need to see ourselves after the flesh anymore and all of its weaknesses. You see, when you keep seeing people after the flesh, I was in a meeting one Sunday morning and in praise and worship. We were singing a song and God spoke to me while we were worshipping. And he just put the word flesh. So just imagine it in your mind. He just put the word flesh in massive big letters across my mind. F-L-E-S-H. I thought, right, Lord, flesh. He said, yes. Now, Maria, I'm going to tell you something this morning. When you start looking at flesh, it will only take you backwards. He says, because spell the word backwards. Take the H away. Take him away. S-E-L-F. When we start looking at people in the flesh, it takes us backwards. God doesn't want us to be going backwards. He wants us to move forward with each other in tow. Be forgiven. You'll have to be. I guarantee you. You'll have to be. Because she's not like you. And he doesn't do it like you do it. So you're going to have to be forgiven. It's good. It releases your life. But God wants us to move forward together. We've not got to see ourselves as flesh anymore. We've got to see ourselves after the Spirit. We are created in the image of Almighty God. Hallelujah. We need to see ourselves in the light of this. Okay, and in closing, Colossians. I'm going to close with the portion of scripture we opened this ladies' weekend up with. In Colossians. Reading from verse 3. You're going to find it, aren't you? If anyone finds it, do you want to stand up and read it? Colossians verse 3. Reading from verse, sorry, Colossians chapter 3, reading from verse 9 to 15. Yes.
And be renewed as you learn to know your Creator.
Yes.
And become like Him. In this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or a Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric, uncivilized, slave or free. Christ is all that matters.
Yes.
And He lives in all of us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes, God chose you to be holy people. He loves you. You must clothe yourselves with tender heart and mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I want to just leave that thought with you today after the things I've shared. There is something that we have to put on. We have to put off, be renewed with the Word of God, and there are things we need to be putting on. And I just want to encourage you this morning. If there are things that you need to be putting on, and just allow God to just come into that area of your life. It might require sacrifice. It definitely requires obedience. But obedience is better than sacrifice, the scripture teaches us. But for some of us, there is a putting off this morning, I believe. And for some of us, there'll be a renewing of our thinking. We'll start thinking differently. Therefore, we'll start believing differently. And for some of us, it's time for a putting on. It's a time to put on that call. Put on that image of Christ. Put on that authority. Put on that strength. And wear it well so that Christ might be glorified in your life. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you, Pastor Maria. I pray that the anointing of the Lord upon your life never go dry in Jesus' name.
The Lord is good. Come see the Lord is good.
Thank you.